Welcome to The Exchange. I'm Dan Riley. The Exchange is a streaming internet talk show and podcast of interviews with noteworthy people about their lives, ideas, and current events.
This week, I sit down with Professor David Grusky, director of Stanford University's Center on Poverty and Inequality. During our conversation, David talks about the history of income inequality in America, the millions of Americans who are currently living in poverty, and potential public policy that could alter the growth of the U.S.'s economic disparity. All right, David. Well, thank you so much for taking time to sit down today, and welcome to the show.
My pleasure to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
My pleasure. Would love to start by learning about you a little bit and your background. Were you always interested in issues of inequality, or was that more of a product of your time in seeing the wealth inequality change in the U.S.?
Well, always is probably an overstatement. It wasn't like right out of the womb and suddenly an interest in inequality, but it was relatively early in my life. In fact, it was at a point in time that predated the takeoff in income inequality. And I couldn't therefore attribute my interest to the takeoff in income inequality itself. Rather it was an interest that arose early in my career, more out of a concern about inequality of opportunity rather than outcome, and in particular that the U.S. isn't delivering on its commitment to social mobility in the way that it should.
What spoke to you about that? What did you learn? What did you read about that indicated to you that those opportunities were diminishing?
Well, I wouldn't say first off that they were diminishing, nor would I suggest that it necessarily came out of book reading. My own life was, I think, an example of privilege reproducing from one generation to the next. My parents, my father is a sociologist. Actually, so too was my grandfather. Mm-hmm. So I'm a third generation sociologist, and so it wouldn't be surprising that perhaps I might have asked why that came about.
Mm-hmm. And did you grow up in a community where inequality was noticeable in your upbringing, or was that something that was a bit, at least at first, more abstract?
I would say it wasn't that noticeable because even then there was much economic segregation. And so I lived in neighborhoods that were relatively well off, and I wasn't then exposed as a result to too much inequality. And of course, we know now that there's rather more economic segregation than was the case then. But even then, it was substantial enough that I would say I wasn't exposed to too much inequality. Hmm.
I know now the issue of income inequality, perhaps because we're not far from a presidential election, is getting a little more airtime than it may normally receive. Looking back in history, in U.S. history specifically, was there a golden age of more equitable income distribution in your mind, or has it really never been particularly equitable?
Well, certainly there was a period in U.S. history, one that we now think is perhaps a departure from the norm, but a period in U.S. history in which there was substantially less income inequality than there is now. After the crash in the 1920s, the market crash, and then the Depression, and subsequently the New Deal, we ushered in an era in U.S. history in which there was substantially less inequality than was the case before then, mm-hmm. and also certainly than is the case now. Mm.
And when we look back at that time regarding the New Deal, I mean, you know, the myth of America, or the story that America generally has liked to tell itself, is one of there is unlimited opportunity, and provided that you work hard and play by the rules, you'll be fine, and this country will take care of you, and you'll gain prosperity. Was that true prior to the crash? And if so, what were the specifics of what the country looked like at that time in terms of wealth inequality?
Well, so prior to the Great Depression, this is the period you're talking about?
Yeah.
There was profound income inequality. So the top 10% of the country in the income distribution controlled about half of total income, and we're now right back to that same number. So So that was a period that was with quite extraordinary inequality. With respect to social mobility, that is the extent to which those who were advantaged at birth were able to subsequently do well themselves. We don't really know as much about long-term trend in social mobility. In fact, one of the great surprises, I think, to many is that the U.S. has not done a good job of monitoring trends in social mobility. And it's something that I've been working on and many others have been working on to try to rectify that situation. But we do not know as much about the long-term trend as we should. So it's just harder to say where we stand now relative to then on mobility. Mm-hmm. But it's quite clear that we stand on matters of income inequality at roughly the same very high level as prevailed at that period, some, I guess, 80 mm-hmm. or so years ago.
Yeah. And when you say use the phrase social mobility, what exactly does that mean? And what in your mind would America look like if social mobility were as robust as it likes to think of itself as?
So, yeah, what do we mean by social mobility? I think the commitment on the part of many Americans, at least, is that we should have a level playing field in the sense that it ought not matter whether you're born into a rich family or a poor family, no matter what your circumstances are at the point of birth or the circumstances of your family are at the point of birth, everyone ought to have an opportunity to get ahead. And the accident of birth shouldn't figure in your opportunities, mm-hmm. in your access to opportunities. That's the ideal. It's a very distinctive part of U.S. history. In fact, if you go back to our early founding documents, you'll see references to the principle of equal opportunity. And so it's deep in the DNA, if you will, of the U.S. to commit to this type of equality of opportunity. Mm-hmm. One might say it's not so deep in the DNA of the U.S. to commit to equality of outcome, but it is deep in the DNA of U.S. to commit to equal opportunity. And so do we live up to that? The evidence is very clear. Like I said, the trend isn't all that clear, mm-hmm. but the evidence with respect to the present day is very clear that there are gross departures from equal opportunity. So, for example, if you're born into the 10th percentile on the income distribution, you're going to make on average about one third of what you'd make if instead you were born into the 90th percentile. Mm. So there are big differences across where you start in terms of where you end up. Mm.
And I'm sure there are multiple obstacles along the way for children that are born into that lower fraction of income. What are sort of the major, you know, two, three, or four obstacles that children of those income distributions face? Is it mostly racial? Is it mostly just pure economic opportunities by schools not being funded enough? What are the major blocks to those opportunities in your view?
There are many inequalities of opportunity that arise, but let me list, as you said, a few of them. So if you're so unlucky, if you will, as to be born into a poor family, that likely means that you're born into a poor neighborhood, because we have this concentration of poverty and concentration of advantage. This is the economic segregation to which we earlier referred. So you're going to be born into a poor family, which has a set of disadvantages associated with it, and also a poor neighborhood typically, which also has some disadvantages associated with it. Perhaps most prominently, you're not likely to have high quality primary and secondary schooling. We know that quality of schooling varies dramatically by neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And so you're going to be saddled with schools that aren't as good. Mm-hmm. And that then doesn't position you for college in the way that children born into a middle-class neighborhood are positioned. So it's that unequal access to quality schooling and then in turn to college that might be identified as one very, very profound set of disadvantages that arise by virtue of being born into a poorer family. Hmm. We can talk about others, but that's a big one. Hmm.
Is that the biggest one in your view?
That probably is the biggest one. Hmm. Yeah. We know that the takeoff in income inequality arises to some large degree through the rising returns to education. That is, the payoff to a college education has gotten larger over the last 50 years or so. Hmm. And that accounts for some of the takeoff in income inequality. So whether or not you can get access to the schooling that has such payoff is going to be a big determinant of where you end up. Hmm.
Is that true across the board in every state in the U.S., or is it more drastic in certain states?
That's a good question. I'm not aware of the evidence on that. We do know that place matters dramatically in terms of the amount of mobility that one can expect. And this is the work that in particular Raj Chetty, who's my new colleague here at Stanford, is justly so famous for delivering. He used IRS tax data to show that children who are born into some neighborhoods have much more opportunity than children born into others. So yeah, place matters quite dramatically.
Yeah. As I mentioned a few minutes ago, in the climate where we find ourselves, there's a Republican debate going on tonight. Who knows if income inequality will be discussed during that conversation? But given that we're in sort of an election climate in the U.S., how do you make of the phenomenon of someone like Bernie Sanders rising to prominence and or at least some degree of popularity? Do you attribute that to his emphasis on economic justice or to other factors?
I think that has to be part of the story. I think one of the big changes of, say, the last 15 to 20 years is not just that folks in the U.S. are increasingly aware of the takeoff in income inequality, but they're more likely to question how it came about, in particular to question the presumption that was once very common that it was simply those who were hard workers or delivering a lot of marginal product who were driving this takeoff in income inequality. I think there's increasingly a recognition that there's lots of rent being collected, rent which could be understood as sweetheart deals, corruption, various perversions of the rules of the game that make it possible for those who have power to do well. And that insofar as you have that kind of sensibility, a candidate like Sanders is going to be attractive to you.
I believe in doing a little research on the work that you've written, in terms of just a time frame of the explosion of the wealth inequality in the U.S., it's generally, I think, marked at roughly 30 years ago is the beginning of the ballooning of the wealth inequality. And correct me if that statistic is off by a bit. But what is the story there? How did we get to where we are now? And what are the specifics of the modern wealth inequality that we see in the U.S.?
Well, I think we know a lot about what drove the takeoff, but there are nonetheless two, I would say, competing sensibilities in understanding those basic facts that are still in play. And so let me lay out those two. And one story simply emphasizes, as I already discussed, the rising returns to schooling and focuses on those rising returns in understanding the takeoff in income inequality. But there's a second sensibility that's not inconsistent with that one, but that focuses instead, as I already discussed, on various ways in which the rules of the game aren't fairly set up and that they privilege certain groups. And some of the takeoff in income inequality can be attributed to the rise of what might be termed rent. So one example would be the rent that accrues to those folks, like myself, who had lots of advantages in accessing high-quality primary and secondary schooling and then going on to college and reaping the benefits that college can deliver. Now, not everyone had those opportunities, so in effect, I'm protected from competition from all those children who were born into poorer neighborhoods who didn't have those opportunities, couldn't go to college, and have reduced, therefore, the supply of folks who have a college degree. Great for me, great for anyone who went to college because it reduces the supply of folks who had that degree and then increases the returns that you secure by virtue of having that degree. You're protected from competition, and that drives up your returns. That could be seen as a type of rent because it's not the returns that would arise if everyone had access to college in a free and open competition of the sort that this country is supposed to deliver. Rather, it's the returns that arise when there's blockages that prevent some people from accessing college. So that's a story that talks about how inequality of opportunity is generating inequality of outcome. And it's just one example of the way in which you can understand the takeoff in income inequality as a type of rent. So it's not enough just to say there are rising returns to education. That's true. But you also have to appreciate why there are rising returns and how that might arise in part, at least, from unequal opportunities to access education.
And when you look at other countries in the world, do you look at some specific nations that are dealing with wealth inequality fairly in your mind? And if so, what are they doing that we aren't?
That's a great question. So one big difference between the U.S. case and most other well-off countries is that we engage in far less redistribution than those countries do. And that accounts for one reason why there's much more inequality in the U.S. in disposable income than is the case in other countries. We just redistribute less. Mm-hmm. But it's a mistake to think that that's the only difference. It is a difference. Mm-hmm. It's an important difference, but not the only difference. What's also different between the U.S. case and that of other many other well-off countries is that the size of the paychecks that we bring home is much more different than is the case in other countries. So the market is generating a lot more inequality in the U.S. than in other countries. And I would attribute that in part, at least, to these various institutions that allow for rent to be collected. Mm. So we have this giant rent-generating machine going on in the U.S. That arises in part because we don't have these equalities of opportunity at all sorts of places throughout the labor market that then generates rent of various sorts and creates paychecks of different sizes. So it's not as if it's fair and open competition that's generating this inequality within the labor market. Rather, it's that we have a whole host of institutions in play that prevent opportunities from being equally distributed. Mm-hmm. So we have a very special type of labor market, mm-hmm. a very special type of labor market, I would argue. Now, this is hardly established. I think we have a lot of work to be done in showing exactly how rent is being collected and generated at various places in the labor market. I've given you a few examples, but this is a place where more research has to be done. But that's my hypothesis, mm-hmm. if you will. Mm-hmm. And so the upshot, though, is that we have two paths to take. We can engage in more redistribution, and surely we should. But we also should take seriously the task of fixing our labor market institutions so that they don't generate so much rent.
One of the things I think that in listening to interviews of Bernie Sanders when he speaks about these issues, that his assault on the unfairness of the system right now is generally not even of people making six figures or $500,000 a year. He seems to direct a lot of his attention to millionaires and even more multimillionaires and billionaires. Mm-hmm. If you can, what are the details of just how much money that very small percentage, I think he usually points to the 0.1% of the U.S. Having a enormous amount of wealth. If you know, what are those statistics and how many people are there in that upper echelon?
I've learned long ago that an attempt to rehearse statistics off the top of my head is bound to go wrong. So I'm not going to try without looking at the data, and I don't have them right at hand now. But he's right to say we're a very special country in terms of the amount of income inequality and wealth inequality that's in play here. We're very, very special.
Yeah. And how do people get into that upper 0.1%? I mean, is it just that once you amass enough capital, the system is arranged as such that there's just almost an inevitable continuous return on having those resources?
Yeah. Well, one thing I think that should be exposed to scrutiny is the extent to which we should allow for wealth to be transmitted directly from one generation to the next. And you might well say that there's nothing within conventional American sensibilities that would suggest that should be the case. Everyone is supposed to start at the same place in mm-hmm. in this great race to get mm-hmm. ahead. And transferring wealth directly from one generation to the next is simply a perversion of that kind of commitment. Mm-hmm. If we really lived up to what we profess to commit to, we would indeed have everyone starting off at the same place and say, okay, have at it. Mm-hmm. Everyone's got the same opportunities. Let's see who prevails. But instead, we explicitly allow for children born into wealth to benefit from that. Mm-hmm. I think it's time to have an open discussion about whether or not that's the kind of labor market and economic system that we want to commit to. Mm-hmm. It doesn't seem consistent with our most fundamental sensibilities. And there have been times in American history in the past when our practices don't align well with our principles, that we've said, okay, we're actually, and it's a pretty amazing thing, right? We're actually going to commit to our principles. We're going to adjust our institutions. They're perfectible institutions. They're human creations. And we're going to realign them to live up to our most profound commitments. I think it's time to do that again.
Mm-hmm. And it seems like the services and the vision that he has for how America can change and should change, and the services that he hopes that he thinks should be provided to every citizen, free healthcare, free tuition at public universities, et cetera. You know, he's viewed, and he is a self-professed democratic socialist. He's viewed as a radical. And I'm wondering if there are other examples that in your research of other American figures that were either very popular or at some point were potential either presidential candidates or otherwise influential or powerful political figures in U.S. history.
Well, it's kind of fascinating because many of those principles and commitments that we once thought of as radical are now seen as mainstream. And so there's, on one hand, this drift to principles that were once seen as leftist, and now we've embraced them and built them into our economic institutions, and they're seen as mainstream. But on the other hand, we've had more recently, in many ways, a rightward drift, in which those sorts of sensibilities that were once seen as extreme right-wing sensibilities have become more mainstream. So there's two kind of countervailing mm-hmm. processes at work over the course of American history mm-hmm. that are quite fascinating.
Mm. I know a lot of people point to FDR as someone that, you know, is a very popular historical president, but would today seem fairly similar to some of those in terms of principles and ideas that Bernie Sanders seems to be promoting. He did promote. So what changed in the U.S.? Is it simply that at that time people were so destitute because of what had happened in the crash that they were willing to reconsider their general economic philosophy for the way America should look, or was it something else?
Well, that's a great question. I couldn't claim to have the answer, but I do think that the Great Recession was a fairly profound event and did lead to some rethinking about our economic system. Now, it seems at this point in time that the rethinking is not nearly as fundamental as was the case after the earlier crash, after the first Gilded Age, right? Mm. That led to some pretty profound institutional changes. Mm. The New Deal and beyond, changes in the way in which we understand labor unions, changes that really ushered in this new era of reduced income inequality. There's no evidence as yet that we're doing anything that profound, but one might say it's still early in the game, and that you can't rule out that ultimately we'll have those institutional changes of the same magnitude. But as yet, mm-hmm. we haven't gotten an institutional return from the Great Recession of the sort that we got out of the Depression.
Hmm. I know the center that you work at here, or the director of here at Stanford, is in part about income inequality, but is also about poverty, which is the other end of the story, right? The opposite of the extreme amounts of wealth are just the enormous numbers of Americans that are living in poverty. What is the picture in 2015 in terms of the poverty levels within the U.S.? And if you could design a change for how we deal with that problem, what would that look like?
So, yeah, we're a special country in terms of having extraordinarily unequal distribution of income and having a very small elite with command over large amounts of income. But we're also special, as you point out, at the other end, in that we run a country that delivers more poverty than most any of our well-off peer countries. Mm-hmm. So we're special at both extremes. Here in California, for example, we have the highest poverty rate across all the states in the U.S. It's very high indeed. We're special. We're exceptionalist. The U.S. has long been represented as exceptionalist, and we are. We are on poverty as well as inequality. I can talk a bit, if you'd like, about how we might go about repairing that.
Sure.
Well, I think here again, the problem is that we are mired in narrow gauge institutional reform, very small stuff, stuff that doesn't appreciate the magnitude of the problem. And so the types of changes and interventions that we discuss are not at all at the right scale. Mm-hmm. And so the first step is to recognize that we've got a problem in terms of scale.
What is the scale at present?
So in California, we have nearly 1 in 5 people in poverty, if you measure it according to the supplemental poverty measure. It's a very high number. Mm-hmm. So what do you do to get institutional reform at the right scale? Well, I think, again, it makes good sense for a variety of reasons to deliver an anti-poverty program that's simply oriented toward equalizing opportunities to everyone. And so a good set of reforms would identify where opportunities are unequal and then do what you need to do in order to equalize them. So first off, access to health care and health practices is very unequally distributed. And so children who are born into poor families aren't going to have the same sort of healthy early beginning that kids from the middle class will have. And so you could, for example, ramp up even more than is already the case, ramp up home visiting programs that provide information, basic, simple, but very important information on healthy practices that will mean that the capacities of children born into poverty will be more nearly equal those born into middle class households. So what we know now is that those early years are very, very important. And so just a simple information intervention like home visiting programs can equalize opportunities to just have a healthy beginning. So that would be step one. That's the first place at which the opportunities are unequal. But then you need to hand off to earlier childhood education. We know too that it's very important. The evidence isn't completely clear, but it's pretty strong that access to high quality early childhood education can have a big payoff. And we know that if you're born into a middle class household, you're going to have great early childhood education. And if you're born into a poor household, you're not going to have that same sort of opportunity. So we got to deliver that. So that's step two. And then you're going to have to equalize access to high quality primary and secondary schooling. We know that's very unequally distributed. It's another place where the playing field isn't level. We've got to level it. And so we can go on, but at each step of the way, there are deeply unequal opportunities. And so if we rectify those, we deliver the same opportunities to all children, that's going to be big reforms, but it would be big payoff because we would reduce poverty in a really substantial way.
Mm-hmm. When we talk about people being at the poverty level, I know that's spoken about in presidential years. What exactly does that mean? What is the cutoff for someone living under the poverty level?
Another number question. I'll do my best. I think roughly for a two-parent, two-child family in a typical county in California, it'd be around 20,000 to 23,000. So the supplemental
household
poverty
income.
Measure. Yeah. Yeah. So the supplemental poverty measure, which many people think is the best poverty measure, takes into account differences in the cost of living across counties. And so that's why it would vary from the low to mid-20s, depending on where you live and what kind of, in particular, housing costs, but other cost of living differences that you're going to encounter. I mean, you think about it. If you're poor in this area, you basically have a big, big choice to make. You can live somewhere on the peninsula where there's fair number of jobs for poor people. People in Palo Alto need those to tend their gardens, take care of their children, run the service operations. But if you want to get those jobs, you can live far away, maybe, you know, a 2-hour commute each way where housing costs are low. But then you're going to have maybe 4 hours a day less to work. So you can either live far away and work maybe 4 hours a day less, or you can live close in, pay a lot more in housing, but be able to work more hours. And so that's the rationale for having a poverty measure that takes into account, say, housing costs. Hmm. There is that trade-off.
Given the numbers, right? If it is 1 in 5 Americans are living at or near or below the poverty line,
California,
but you know, tens of millions of Americans that are in that situation. What do you make of the lack of general grassroots political activism for changing the economic structure of the way that America fundamentally works?
Another very tough question. I think part of it is a misunderstanding of how poverty is generated, and that a failure to appreciate that one very important reason, not the only reason, mm-hmm. but one very important reason why we have so much poverty in California is that we don't have equal opportunities to get ahead. Mm. That if you're born into a poor family in a poor neighborhood, there's systematic restriction of opportunities at every step of the way. Mm-hmm. And that means that a child born into poverty has a much elevated chance of him or herself ending up in poverty. And that if we could just get rid of those inequalities of opportunity, we would go a long way to reducing mm-hmm. poverty. But people don't see poverty in those terms. Mm-hmm. They don't understand that it arises to the extent that it does from unequal opportunities. If they did appreciate that, my view is that they would commit much more profoundly to doing what's necessary to reducing poverty. But rather, they see poverty as a consequence of behaviors that for which they blame the individual undertaking those behaviors.
Mm. Is that a part of the American fabric that pick yourself up by your bootstraps, working hard is just so difficult for it's hard for Americans to shake themselves out of that mindset that it's more difficult to implement the sort of more socialistic tendencies than we see in Western Europe?
Well, I would say, you know, it's not about implementing socialistic programs and reforms. It's actually implementing programs and reforms that are pretty mainstream commitments in the U.S. The commitment to equal opportunity mm-hmm. is as mainstream as it gets. Mm-hmm. Not socialism, at mm-hmm. least as it's conventionally understood.
Right.
It's just doing what we think is supposed to be done in the context of some of our most profound mainstream commitments to equal opportunity. Mm-hmm. So it's not that we're asking people to do something that's inconsistent with standard issue American sensibilities. We're asking people to do what they mm-hmm. conventionally believe is part of what this country should be doing. Mm-hmm. It's just not appreciated that we're not doing that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Last question I want to ask you, and I alluded to this a little while ago. If you were king for a week, or you know, you were president, what are the moves you would make? And maybe it is primarily in the education realm. Maybe it's increasing taxes in some form. What are the two or three things immediately off the bat that if you, with a stroke of a pen, could change them, you would do to decrease the inequality of the U.S.?
I like this idea. King for a day. I would say we should step back and test all of our labor market, schooling, and other institutions again with a single litmus test. The single litmus test is it delivering equal opportunity to all children? And if it is, wonderful. Mm-hmm. If it's not, let's do what's necessary to ensure that it lives up to that commitment. And so just step back. We get used to our institutions. We take them for granted. We think they're inevitable and immutable and mm-hmm. unchangeable, but there's nothing more American at the end of the day than the view that we can mm-hmm. create our institutions. That's the American dream. And so we should test and measure every institution we have against that single very, very important test. That's what I did.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, David, thank you so much for coming on the show. I appreciate it.
Thanks for inviting me.
Thanks for listening. If you're interested in learning more about The Exchange, want to listen to episodes online, or would like to reach out to the show, feel free to visit the show's website at theexchangeshow.com.